Hey guys. Oh, how are you doing today? I wish we were doing better. To be quite honest, we are again sick again. Last time you saw my podcast, it was not this past Friday, but the previous Friday. I had brought my daughter to the doctor because of an earache. And she just had an upper respiratory illness, which then got passed to me, which now my son has. The beauty of life, this never-ending cycle. Please be over. Oh, I hope it's over soon. So, pardon my voice. My voice is very weak. I've been coughing for 9 days straight, which is quite awful. As you'll notice, I have my glasses on today. I haven't been wearing my contacts because my eyes have been so runny and horrible, so I don't want to put any germs on my contact lenses that would get, again, transmitted back to my eyes. So, glasses it is until we're all healed, so. I know it's a little depressing of a way to start this, but it's snowing outside. Did you see? I put in some footage at the beginning here of just some snowfall. We're getting a little bit of snow today that will melt, and then we'll get re-snowed on in a couple days. Some folks are more into snow than I am, but just means winter's here. It's New England. Today is 30. Tomorrow will be 50 degrees, and then the next day we're gonna get snow again. So welcome to how fickle New England is, but welcome to my podcast. This is a crochet, knitting, mostly yarn dyeing, sometimes spinning, crafty podcast. My name's Kayleen, and I'm your host. I'm the principal fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Littlebean Crochet on Etsy, and Littlebean loves hand-painted yarn, and I'll always, as always, I put my information down here at the bottom of the video. I apologize for any ambient noises. You'll notice I'm back in my living room. my craft room is a bit of a mess right now because I've been dying so heavily yesterday and today. There's just stuff everywhere. I had to turn the heat up because it was a little cold, so we might hear the radiator click on at some point, but anyway, I have a few things to share with you today. I have a dye topic that I want to talk about with you today, and a little bit of progress on some works that I've been doing. So we'll just jump right into it. I don't have any finished objects, big surprise. I have not been able to do too much in the way of fiber works in the last couple days here, last week or so, only because I've been feeling so awful and I haven't been sleeping, so complain, sorry. This is real life. But I did get a chance to work on a project that's been languishing for quite some time because I want it off my needles, and I did a little bit on my socks, so I'll show you that right now. So my socks are still living in this little casual fashion queen bag. And these are my two-at-a-time gradient socks. As you guys know, I got a sock knitting machine to do shop samples and such. I've been wanting to play with that a little bit more, experiment with settings and how to knit socks on it, but I haven't had a chance to since I've been so ill. So I just have been knitting slightly on these. I think there's maybe a half of an inch of progress since last time you saw. Not very much, but they're still existing. They're getting worked on at the playground. You know, places that I can just easily tick along and not worry too much. It's not too involved of a project. So 60 stitches, two at a time, magic loop. These are size 1 Addy Turbo Sock Rockets. I love these needles, they're super sharp, which will bring me to another point in a second when I show you my next work in progress. So for those who have been watching the podcast for a while, you will recognize this bag. This is my Mrs. Brown's bag. It doesn't get shown very often, but I love this bag. This is the Yarn Splat fabric, which I really love. Here's the little taggy taggy. Brown's bags. I absolutely love this bag. It's larger than you would think. It's bigger on the inside. But it opens up nicely, has a nice wide box base. But in this bag is my Coastline shawl by I never know how to say her name. Janina Callio. I think that's how you say it. Or Janina. I don't know. It's J-A-N-I-N-A. I think it's Janina, but I couldn't tell you. So I've been working on this shawl. I'm in the middle of a row here. I've just started another round of lace. But I started this project I'm gonna say sometime over the summer last year, right when I started podcasting, because it was right after I got the yak basin. This is a yak sock base that I don't carry all that often. I'm going to be putting my rainbow set back in the shop probably this weekend, which is on the yak base. I think it's a 70% superwash merino, 25% yak, 5% nylon. I'm pretty sure. I don't know. If I'm wrong, I'll just correct it on the screen. And then this is my MCN base. This color was a one-of-a-kind pot soaker color. It was part of my Anarchy dye. I did some Sherlock-inspired colors, and this is Mrs. Hudson. It was just this really nice kind of browny, mauvey tonal. So this is the Coastline shawl. I wish there was an easier way to show you, but it is a semi-circular type shawl. And when it is, so this is the cast on edge. So I cast on using a garter tab, which is quite common. This is a paid for pattern, but it's quite a common cast on for our center out shawls. And then I continued along the garter panels, the lace detail, another garter panel. So last time you saw my shawl, I was still in the garter panel, the second round of garter stitch here. I think I had just gotten maybe halfway, not even halfway. And then I was just waiting to get to the next lace repeat. I'm finding this not enjoyable, not because of the pattern. The pattern's actually quite simple. The problem that I'm having is the lacing, the lace detailing, and my needles. I couldn't quite figure out why this has sat so long, because I really enjoy the way this final product is going to look, and I like the lace detailing. I love the colors that I chose for this. I love the yarn that I'm stitching with, and it really kind of comes down to my needles. So I love Carbon's needles. I do. These are just a set of fixed circulars. These are US size 5. A couple things. I selected my needle size. I can't remember. I'd have to go back and look. But in this pattern, I think you're supposed to be using a US size 6, which is part of the problem, I think, is that I didn't have a size 6 available, and I didn't think using, size 4 millimeters or US size 6. I don't know if I misread and thought it was a US size 4 and I thought I would use a 5. Or if I downsized intentionally. At this point, I can't remember. So I was feeling very frustrated because I thought my shawl wasn't growing as quickly as I wanted, even though I was nearly halfway through the pattern. I'm like, how is this going to get any bigger? So it's growing more now that I'm almost done with this lace repeat, but it's still not as large as I anticipated it to be, and I think that is attributed to my needle size. But more so than that is the tips on my carbons. While they are pointy, they're pointier, I feel like, than the other, because these are Knitter's Pride carbons. The other Knitter's Pride metal needles, what are they called? Platina, Nova Platinas. I feel like they're sharper a little bit than those, but I found the same issue when I started working on my socks, and I cast them on my Nova Platinas, that even working with, I mean, these are smaller needles, so it's hard to really compare, but you can see that the point, see how much pointier the tip is on this than here? It's a much sleeker presentation. There's almost like a shelf where it gets kind of pointy, but then it gets wide very quickly. So I'm not enjoying knitting on this because I think I don't like the needles for this project, and it's a little bit frustrating because I enjoy carbon needles. But I don't think I enjoy them, excuse my congestion, I don't think I enjoy them for lace, for whatever reason. And for fine work like that, I'm not finding the yarn to be splitty or anything, so it's like I don't think my needles are too sharp for what I'm working on, or the weight of yarn that I'm working, but I'm finding that the knit two togethers are not pleasurable in any way. Like, I find myself getting extremely frustrated when I'm doing some knit two togethers. And then so on this project also, I think my stitch count is wrong. I'm following the prescribed pattern. I've had to tink back this lace. Let's see if it'll focus. I've had to tink back this lace several times. So here's the lace patterning. It should pretty much line up down the shawl. And then this latest row, my lace is here. And it should be here. So I'm off by... So it's starting here, and it should be starting here. I think I'm off by 4 stitches. So it's kind of frustrating because I haven't bothered counting my stitches because the pattern, I'd have to go back and do a ton of math because the pattern doesn't give, so I'm gonna cover the pattern, but it doesn't give the totals every row. It gives the totals after every section. You have now 336 stitches. That's it once I finish the lace section. I just don't want to show the pattern. But it's just, baby's crying. He doesn't feel good. So I'm finding that very frustrating. The math isn't that hard. Every 2 rows I'm increasing, I think it's 10 stitches. Somewhere like that. I don't think it's 10 stitches because 1, 2, 3, 4. No, maybe it's 10 stitches. I don't know. I think I'm increasing 10 stitches, somewhere thereabouts. But somehow I keep getting off on this lace section, and though I haven't gotten too far in terms of like distance around to the other end of the shawl, I already have to tink back like 50 stitches because I don't know, back here it's hard to tell where your lace is lining up, and it's not until you get like 1, 2, 3 rows, 3 repeats of the lace patterning in when you really find out if it's lined up or working or not. So now I have to tink back on this again, which is making me not want to knit on it because I hate tinking back, and I don't care about mistakes because everybody makes mistakes. And in my crochet, you know, I'll fudge whatever, as long as it's not like something I'm doing, you know, as a professional for someone else. If it's something for myself, I don't care if there's a mistake in it, as long as it doesn't detract too much aesthetically from the final piece or doesn't affect the fit or function of the piece. So this is going to detract a lot aesthetically because it's a very distinctive lace pattern. It's very clear where the lace eyelets are, so I have to take. So this is a timeout again, but I've been working on it, and I think I've done, you know, I think the last time you saw me, I was like right before needing to start this next lace panel, so I've worked a ton of rows into the lace paneling. That didn't focus. There we go. So, and there are 300 some odd stitches in this row, and it takes me 15 minutes if I don't have to tink back to go back this entire row. Well, so that's it, and I mean, I like the shawl in it. I love the final look of the shawl, and I love the pattern. I just am not loving on the project right now, and it makes me feel very frustrated because I want to love on it, but I just want it off my needles at this point because I want to cast on something else. I kind of want to cast on the cozy shlanket by Mina Philip. If you guys have seen her podcast, she's released a couple of shawl patterns. She just released the Snow Day shawl pattern, which I purchased, and the Cozy Shlanket, which I purchased. I think the Snow Day shawl is either in a DK or a sport weight. I feel like maybe it was a DK weight, and then the Cozy Shlanket is in a worsted or an Aran weight. So I thought that would be really nice to do a heavier weight shawl. Fingering weight shawl is taking forever. Okay, so then let's talk about dye work. Things that I've done. So I did some experimentation on my circular sock machine this week, and I knit up some gradients where I'm just making a pre-knit fabric. My circular sock machine is a speedster, an Erlbacher Gearhart speedster, and it's a 1-to-1 crank ratio. So it's much easier for me to crank blanks on this machine because it's a little more heavy duty. It's all metal gearing and metal tooling. I do have to put a substantial amount of weight on the tube to make sure that I'm knitting out. but with that comes a smaller diameter. And also, you know, tension becomes an issue sometimes or whatever. But I successfully did it with two 100 gram skeins and a couple of mini skeins. And I do have some cones of yarn that I'm going to be using for self-striping and also for some more gradients. So being able to crank a custom gradient from a cone will be much nicer for me, because I can give you longer skeins. Because right now I was using just the pre-skeined skeins to make my gradients, which is limited to, you know, 463 yards for fingering weight. So yeah, I'll be happy to do that soon. But this is the one that's left. One of them is already gone. I had done two. So this is just a blue gradient. It's not a true navy here. It's a custom blend of colors. So you can see it's very vibrant, but very deep. And it fades out into this nice, kind of like ocean-y blue, and then into some cream. So I'm very happy with how this came out. This is a very beautiful gradient. and I think I might be knitting my gradients up on the sock machine from now on, as long as it's not too heavy of a weight to use in the sock machine, just because it's easier on my arm. It's one revolution for one round of the needles. And my Addy King, it's, I think, 6 revolutions of my arm for one revolution of the needles, which is a lot, which means for a 463 yard skein, I usually have 350 revolutions, somewhere thereabouts, which means, I'm sorry, it's 11 revolutions of my arm for one revolution of the needles. So 11 times 350, that's how many times my arm has gone around doing a single fingering weight skein. But on my Speedster circular sock machine, I can do it much more quickly and with fewer revolutions, so I'm not falling apart. There's that for you. Okay, and I did want to touch on a dye topic today before I get into, you know, general life happenings or shop update stuff. You can see behind me here, there's a set of 4 purple skeins. I have to talk to the customer because I'm having some issues with this purple dye, and it's really frustrating for me, and I want to make sure she gets her order. But these 4 skeins were dyed using the same pot, the same amount of the same dye, and I have 4 different tones, 4 different saturation levels, some speckling that is unintentional. So I want to share this with you because I know a lot of folks are curious as to what goes into dyeing yarn and what happens between the pot, it coming out of the pot and getting shipped to you. And so I want you to know that I take extreme care in what I do, and I very much care about the product that comes to you. And things like this happen very frequently, especially with powdered, I'm using powdered dyes. And if things aren't just right in terms of the water, the acidity of the water, the temperature, there are certain dyes that are really prone to break and are really difficult to use. And this is one of those colors. And I really love this color. I used it in my Bellatrix colorway. I did have some breaking of the color in my skeins of that colorway, which was totally fine for me. I enjoyed the breaking of it. I thought it lent some character. But this is a purple yarn. And you can see here, the color is broken. So the color is supposed to be a blue tone purple. I have 2 purples that are in my shop that are like mid-tone purples, and one is blue tone and one is more red toned. So cool and warm tones here. I wish this would focus. Okay, so you can see here that the yarn is mostly purple, kind of a blue tone purple, but I have these breaks of color that are kind of a navy blue. And there are tiny, faint speckles through this entire skein of yarn that are of a navy blue type color. So I'm not sure how well the camera is picking it up because it's difficult to see here, but they're tiny, tiny, tiny speckles. Now when I mix dye, I mix the powder up into a little bit of a slurry, get it all mixed, and I use hot water. I use hot water and acetic acid in the water, when I'm mixing the dye to make sure I get good suspension and that it's going to bind to the fiber really well. But I mix up the dye slurry and then I add hot water and I mix it some more and then I shake it some more to make sure everything is fully dissolved. because dye mixtures, if you're not using just a primary color, they can break depending on the dye formula. This is still a little wet, so I want to take this off my shoulder. So the dye can break and sometimes doesn't get taken up at the same rate as the other colors. So red molecules are smaller, the dye particles and dye molecules are smaller, so they're usually taken up into the fiber first, and then blue is taken up after because the molecules are larger. So I pulled the skein out from my dye yesterday and I immediately noticed that the breakage had happened. So I decided I'm gonna dye it again. And these are just, I dyed them up single. Here we go, some single skeins. You can see it's blue here and then here's the purple color. So this was the first dye. It broke and I'm like, son of a biscuit, why did you do that? So that means I have to dye it again. No big deal, it's just a tonal, I can do it again, it's repeatable, I use the same amount of dye. But you can see the blue here. If this were a speckled colorway or, you know, a colorway that I didn't mind the breakage of the color or I expected it to break, it would be a different story because hand-dyed yarn is unique. It's not identical all the time, and that's part of the beauty that I find in it. There's consistency generally, but if something unexpected happens with the dye and you can replicate it, then it usually lends to more interest in the yarn. So I dyed again and I did the same method that I always do, which usually produces a good result, and for some reason in this dye a second time it broke again. Now this is not something I'm going to send to the customer because the customer wanted tonal mini skeins, and this has color breaks in it that aren't consistent with the color of the yarn. So if it was maybe some darker purple speckling or something, like it was a small variation of this tone, it might be acceptable. I would ask the customer and say, like, you know, would you like this? I can dye it again, you know, because unexpected things happen and sometimes it ends up being what we wanted to see anyway. So it broke. So I put it away last night. I said I have to think about what I'm going to do because, again, it's broken. So got the same kind of tone. This is a little pinker. This is a little bluer. Same amount of dye. Same dye pot. Like same dye pot. Like the physical pot of dye was the same. So, you know, and I shake the dye when I use it because the dye particles will settle. Some particles are larger than others or heavier than others, and so like that will lead to the dye powder not being evenly distributed. Even though they're mixed at the factory, I always shake them before I use them because I want my dyes to be consistent. So that was the first try. So this morning I woke up and I said, okay, I'm gonna try this again, because now I'm really wanting to ship this yarn out today, which now I don't know if this is gonna happen unless I can dye some miracle. This is the same dye. This came out much more red than this. This is somewhere along the lines of the color that it should be. This looks like plum to me. My plum dye looks exactly like this. But again, I did a different, I did the same preparation method, but this time I changed a little bit of the order in which I did things, the temperature of the water, and it came out like this. And it still broke. So these are even finer speckles here, but the tone of the yarn is wrong. So you can see the speckles. Very frustrating. This is still slightly damp. I'm gonna let this fully dry. But again, not the right tone, even though it's the same dye. It's the same dye. Like, how is this possible? I've never had this much of a problem with this color before, and I don't know why. So then I decided, well, I'm getting these blue speckles. It's not incorporating the way it needs to for whatever reason. Maybe I can filter out the larger blue molecules to help achieve the color to be more consistent. So then this is still, it's still damp. So again, I have a different color. I have four different colors from the same amount of dye and the same base of yarn, all with different changes in the method of dyeing, because I'm trying to achieve a solid color. I don't understand the problem with this dye right now. It is absolutely maddening to me. It's incredibly frustrated. I think that the closest in tone to what this dye should be looking like are these. This looks browner, even though it's gonna dye a bit brighter, but it's not, I mean dry, it's gonna dry a bit brighter, but it has no speckles, but the tone of the yarn is wrong. So I'm gonna have to go back to the drawing board in terms of mixing the dye for this color, changing my procedure again. And I have to email the customer because her order is gonna get delayed. I already told her that she was on my dye queue for yesterday, which she was, but this is kind of an unforeseen circumstance. So, a lesson for dyers. There are certain things that you can do to help with unintentional speckling, and filtering is one of those things. Again, I mixed the dye the same way I normally did. This time I filtered it through a coffee filter, shook it again, put it in the water, heated the water, and then this is the result. And then for folks who are customers of independent dyers, know that a lot of care goes into the yarn that comes your way. Even if it's something as simple as a tonal, it's not that simple sometimes, depending on the dye formula. So when you ask about how long something will take, or why does it take 5 days to dye or dry or whatever, like people give you a window of expectation, it's to account for things like this, because this is an unforeseen circumstance. Something like this has never happened to me in all the time I've been dyeing. I've never had such a problem with a specific color before. So, dye topic for the day. I hope you found that informative. Let these dry now. So we can move on to other things. We can move on to, oh, we need to do the giveaway. So I'm going to pick a random number between 2 and 28. Can you pick a random number between 2 and 28?
The answer is 2.
So there we go, number 2. Is the winner. All right, so the winner here is Sylvia1002. That's your username on Ravelry. And the question, the prompt I had was, what is your favorite animal? She said, my favorite animal would have to be dogs. That's right, dog mama here. Dogs love unconditionally and are always happy to see you. Meaning they act like you've been gone forever, even if you just walked out the door and came back inside immediately. How can you resist that love? So that's her post here. So congratulations to you, Sylvia. You are the winner of a skein of Bellatrix. If you can send me a private message on Ravelry, that would be great. and I'll get your prize out to you as soon as I get it skeined up. Because I still haven't skeined it. It needs to be skeined. But it will be coming to you, so congratulations. Okay, so that being said, I want to talk about the dyes that I've done this week. So if you're not interested in shop update information, I'll see you next time. Or personal stuff, I'll see you next time. But if you are interested in that stuff, you can just stay right here. And I'm going to show you what I dyed up this week so far and what will be going into the shop. So, the first thing I want to show you are some yarns that I've dyed. So this color I haven't dyed in a while. This is Slytherin Common Room. It's really deep navies, greens, yellows, blues. The Slytherin Common Room is underneath the Black Lake, so I kind of wanted to get that underwater, kind of ghostly, almost evil, like murky type, like reflection, or like, you know, if you're thinking about the sunlight coming through this murky kind of lake, you get these dark, shadowy yellows or blues, greens, and the colors of Slytherin being, you know, green. I thought it really lent well to it, so this is it. I have it on here on Simple Sock and Luxe DK, but I've done it across almost all the bases, at least a few skeins of each. So if this is a color you're interested in, come check out the shop update on Saturday. And then also, I had a custom request for flowers for Dobby, so I thought I would just dye up a bunch. This is flowers for Dobby. The top is on Sparkle Sock, and then this is Everyday Sock. I don't know if you can see the sparkles. It's so pretty. So it's kind of a grayish toned yarn with parts of like grays and sandy type browns, kind of like Dobby's pillowcase that he wears. And then pink speckles for his love for his friends and their love for him, and the flowers at Shell Cottage where he's buried. So flowers for Dobby is one of my favorite colors that I've ever made. So I have this across several bases as well, a few skeins of each available, so if it's something you're interested in, Saturday will be the update. Social media, in terms of social media, the easiest place to find me is Instagram. I always announce things on Instagram first, which cross posts to Facebook. and then the other thing that I'm going to have in the shop are some Yarn Love tins. So this is part of my logo. The Littlebean Loves hand-painted yarn logo. It's a bit of Yarn Love. And these are Notions tins. So I placed an order with the sexy knitter, Sarah, because I'm in love with these tins. I think they're such a smart idea. And I wanted to have some for my business to be available for you that have my logo on it, because I love my logo. It's a little Yarn Love. So I want to show you this tin without tipping it too much. So as you can see, these are fully stocked tins. They have all your kind of necessary knickknacks for your project. There's a very strong magnet on the top of these, which has some needles incorporated. So there are a couple of sewing needles, like more pointy needles, and then a larger embroidery needle. Then we also have a stitch holder, just a plain metal stitch holder. we have this really cute lamb measuring tape. So these are, they're different colors. This one just happens to be white. They're different colors in every tin. I don't know what's in every single tin. It's a surprise. And then we have a needle gauge, which is a ball of yarn. It's just, some lightweight wood. But if your needles are older and you can't see the sizes anymore, the needle gauge is a useful tool to have. Or if you've forgotten, you have a long languishing project, kind of like that, and you can't read the numbers anymore, you can know which size needle you're on. This is just a simple row counter with some gems, some plastic gems on it. It's really pretty. There's a metal cable needle in here, just kind of a standard. And then we have this little multi-tool. So this is just a small crochet hook. It's just a small crochet hook. It's double-ended, so you can pick stitches up very easily. It says it's a 2mm and a 3.5mm hook, one on each end. I find having a crochet hook very, very helpful. I have had to use them before, especially in my socks. And I usually just keep a crochet hook because I'm a crocheter, but if you're a knitter and you don't and you want something small, this is perfect. You also get a pair of snips. They're just basic scissors to have in your pouch. Spring-loaded scissors. Nothing too fancy, but very essential. And then we have some stitch markers and progress keepers. So Sarah makes these little origami stars. I don't know if you can see them very well. It's hard to hold these up. They're all different colors, they're random colors in each one. But they're just little knit stitch markers that have a cute bead at the bottom. And they're just paper origami stars. So they're super, super light. They won't catch on anything. These seem to be no catch stitch markers, which are great, but I thought these were so cute. And then the last piece are some progress keepers or stitch markers for crochet, all different colors of the rainbow. There are 5 of these as well in there, which is usually more than enough than what you need in your project. But you're always free to add what you like, but these I find are very essential. I'm always hunting these down. So that's it. That's everything that's included in this. I kind of want to keep one of these for myself because it has items in it that I am constantly looking for. But I want to give you guys a chance to get it first because I can always order myself one from her directly. But yeah, this is probably one of the most comprehensive little Notions kits that I've seen. And then everything fits in here. So everything closes in here together. There's a lot in here for a small kit, and they're relatively small. I mean, I think I could even put one of these in the bottom of this bag, and this is a tiny little bag, and still have room for my project, which I think I'm going to try and do right now. This fits just fine. So it's a perfect little tin, fits right in. It really doesn't take up much room at all. You can see right there. And it has everything that you would need to manage your project while you're working on. So those will be in the shop. There will be 12 of them available for you if you want one. And I like that, you know, she has a lot of different options for what you can put on the front of these tins. It's just a paper sticker. But it looks very clean and polished. But I really like my logo. And plus I wanted it to kind of match the feeling of my shop and what I love, which is yarn. So yarn love tins will be coming at you on Saturday. So I'm super excited about these. Thank you so much, Sarah. These are beautiful. And yeah, so very exciting, very, very exciting. All right, that is all I have for you today. My voice is slowly going away, moment by moment. So I hope you have a great week. I'm sorry I didn't get to this on Friday, but I didn't have a voice on Friday, and I'm still recovering today. So yeah, have a wonderful week. And let me know if you have any questions for me. You can always leave them in the comment section down below. If you like the video, make sure you like it. And if you'd like to be notified of when I upload a new video, make sure you hit the subscribe button down below. There's also a little bell that comes up next to the subscribe button, and it will push a notification to your phone or email letting you know that I've uploaded a video. So that being said, have a fantastic week, and I'll see you next time. Bye!